The opinions expressed on the Simone Edwards Show by our guests are solely the opinions of the original source who expressed them. They do not necessarily represent the opinions of the station, its owners, and or the Simone Edwards Show and those affiliated with it. In no event will the Simone Edwards Show, this station, its owners, guests, hosts, or affiliates be liable for the information disseminated on the program, including, without limitation, any loss or damage, indirect or otherwise, arising from information presented on the show. We trust you are of legal age and will consult appropriate professionals prior to employing any opinion expressed on the show. Many of the topics discussed are personal in nature, and some people may disagree with the opinions expressed on the show. We are open to your constructive criticism and or ideas for future radio programs. Please feel free to email us at thesimoneedwardsshow@gmail.com. Again, that's thesimoneedwardsshow@gmail.com. Hey everyone, we want to welcome you to another installment of the Simone Edwards Show here on this station. It is the third Saturday in January. The year is moving along kind of at a really nice pace. I'm really happy about that. I don't feel like, wait a minute, slow down, or whoa, can it go faster? It's moving along at a great pace. And because it is the third Saturday, it is our Women on the Move series. It used to be called Girl, Can We Talk? But we've talked and we've been established, so now we're moving. Awesome. Our first guest for 2017 for the Women on the Move series is this dynamic young woman here with me. Her name is Brittany Cooper of the Fly Curve. She's also an anointed psalmist here in the city of San Diego, soon to be a household name. So Brittany, say hi to everyone.
Hello, everyone, and thank you so much for having me. This is truly an honor.
Oh, my pleasure, my pleasure. We've been trying to get this thing going for a minute.
It's been a long time.
Yeah.
But we got it.
We are here. So before we jump off into the deep end, let's get to know you a little bit.
Okay,
so if you had to describe yourself in five words, using five words, what five words would you use to describe Brittany?
Okay, I'm going to go with ambitious.
Okay.
Sarcastic.
Really?
But it's never to be, you know, mean.
Right.
You know, it just comes out. I don't know where it comes from.
Okay.
I'm going to say so I said sarcastic. I said
ambitious,
mm-hmm. funny, mm-hmm. Engaging, and comedic. I'll say that.
Nice. Okay, so
that was on the fly. So,
where's your comedic chops come in?
It really comes out around friends because I'm actually a shy person, so it can be mistaken as, you know, she's aloof or she's mean, but really I'm just shy. But
when I'm
around my friends and my homies, you know, we have a crack up good time.
Oh, nice. Very nice. Okay, what accomplishment to date are you the most proud of?
I'm most proud of graduating from college. I went to San Diego State.
Girl, go ahead.
Thank you, girl. And I'm most proud of it because I did not graduate. I didn't do the traditional route of going from high school to college. Mm-hmm. It took me a long while to find myself and what I wanted to do.
Right.
So I went to college right after high school, didn't work out. Worked in the workforce for a while, and then I decided to go to college. So I actually did. I just graduated from college in 2012. I graduated from high school in 2004.
Congratulations.
So, thank you. So it was a process.
So if I can just throw this really quick sidebar in there for those who are listening, it is never too late.
Never.
It really
isn't.
It's
really not.
And you don't have to follow everybody else's path.
No.
When it's time for you to go, just go.
Go. Absolutely.
Okay. I love it. I absolutely love it.
Thank you.
So what was your major?
I majored in communication.
Okay.
Right, so it has nothing to do with what I'm doing now, but who knows what the future holds. Mm-hmm. But I just felt like it was a universal major,
right?
And it wasn't too specific to anything. So I always felt if I wasn't going to be a doctor or an engineer, just kind of, you know, widen my scope a little bit.
That's really good. And the skill set that you learned and the tools that you learned really benefit you in your business.
Absolutely, because you learn how to communicate with different ethnicities. You know, there's cultural differences in the way, you know, you would communicate with different ethnic backgrounds. So you learn that. You learn how, you know, your tone and how, you know, you learn different things. So it was really a great experience.
Excellent. I love it.
Thank you, girl.
Looking forward to great things from you. Okay, so tell me, what's on your bucket list?
Or your life list.
Okay. Well, yeah.
Some people hate the bucket term. So.
Well, one thing that's on my bucket list, I really want to buy my parents a house. Aww. Now, I know that they might, have already bought a house before I get to this, but I really, really wanted, I've always thought about it. I've always wanted to do it, and I just pray that one day I'm able to just be like, look, whatever you want, just buy it. You know, mm-hmm. So that's definitely on my bucket list. And also, I always want to go to Italy. So okay. That's definitely on my life list.
I love it. Well.
Thank you.
So, in your mind's eye, like, what's your dream home? What's a dream home that you'd want to get for your parents?
Okay, so my dad, he's a jack of all trades. So mm-hmm. He does welding and he does, you know, barbecue. He has his barbecue pits. He likes to build them. Mm-hmm. So, you know, in San Diego, it's kind of city metropolitan. There's really no place for it, even though their current house. He makes space for it. Right. But I just see him living on a big property where he's able to do whatever he wants and have enough room so that, you know, no one's irritated that he has, you know, everything outside.
Okay. That's awesome. Yeah. That is so wonderful. I love that. Something that some of our listeners, those who are familiar with you, will know. Okay. Those who are not familiar, you're in for a treat. Maybe we can get her towards the end of the show. Uh-oh. To share some of her gift with us. But oh, she's an amazing singer, an anointed singer. And thank so, so what genre of music or what type of music within the genre has influenced you the most?
Well, I mean, I think music is universal. Right. So, when I was younger, I was a huge R&B fan. Okay. And then, you know, gospel, of course, Clark Sisters, mm-hmm. You know, Kim Burrell, Shirley Caesar, all the old school people. Mm-hmm. Well, actually, Clark Sisters is still booming now. But you know what I mean. Just like that old school gospel choir feel.
Okay.
And then on
Mississippi Mass?
That type of stuff. Yeah, okay. Mississippi Mass, Hezekiah Walker, you know, of course, Kirk Franklin, those types of things. And then I'm a huge jazz fan, so, mm-hmm. You know, Billie Holiday, Sarah Vaughan.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, I've always wanted to articulate like Billie Holiday.
Yeah.
So those were some of my favorites coming up, you know, Faith Evans. Those jazzy, they would infuse jazz notes in their music, and mm-hmm. I've always been a huge fan of that. So I like all kinds of music. So
nice.
Really not a singular thing, but definitely gospel, definitely R&B, jazz, late, oldies jazz, though.
What about Nina Simone?
Nina Simone. She's a huge fave of mine.
Love her.
And I had actually, I go off on tangents, and mm-hmm. I was on a Aretha tangent, really heavy, like mm-hmm. 2014. Mm-hmm. I was obsessed with her reading autobiographies and just really, you know, so I go, that happens to me a lot.
Yeah, but I mean, there's a reason why she's called the Queen of Soul,
exactly.
Though.
She's amazing.
Yeah.
She really is. And the things that she's accomplished is really unparalleled. So yeah. I love her.
Yeah, it kind of bums me out. I mean, I don't get too heavy into celebrities one way or the other.
Mm-hmm.
I kind of tend to kind of be like Switzerland a lot
of
times.
Right, right, okay.
But she gets dogged out sometimes, presently in the media, and it really bothers me. It's
she
kind
does.
Of like,
but I really think that she's unbothered.
Yeah.
Like, I really think that she doesn't care, even though I might be caring.
Right.
So it's like, it's interesting.
Yeah.
But she does get a bad rap. But I remember, for instance, when Obama had her sing at the inauguration, people were like, why on earth would you have Aretha? Are you kidding me?
But did she tear it up?
Did she not tear it up,
oh
though?
My God.
And then aside from that, she was around in the 60s, in the, you know, whenever all of this civil unrest was happening. She deserved to be there. So I did, that was my little, you know, thing for her. But I love her. I love all music, though.
Okay.
I can find something good in anything.
Oh, that's good. I like that. That's really good. So segueing into that,
okay.
What are your top five personal values? And the other side, the flip side of that coin, what are your deal breakers?
Okay.
Okay.
So my top five qualities are integrity.
Mm-hmm.
I just feel like you just have to have integrity.
Yeah.
You know, there's enough room for everyone.
Mm-hmm.
So integrity is key. Being respectable.
Mm-hmm.
No matter who you're talking to, everyone is deserving, you know, of respect.
Right.
And honesty, keeping it real. Like, let's just all be real about what's happening,
mm-hmm.
you know, no matter what's going on. So that's three. Okay. Mm-hmm. So honesty, integrity, respectability, and No condescending behaviors at mm-hmm. all.
Okay.
And
so is that a deal breaker?
Yeah, I don't like that.
Okay.
I don't like when people get into a certain position and they feel like it's okay to, you know, look down on others.
Okay.
So that's, those are my main. Those okay. are my main ones. Like, that's what I try to, you know, of course, no one's perfect, but those are the real ones that I really, I elaborate on those a lot.
Okay. That's good. It's kind of like if you were a car, that's your engine.
Yes.
Okay. I like that. Okay.
Thank you.
Did you have another two for your, because you had integrity. Let's see. You had, let me see if I remember. I'm going to work on my memory.
Okay.
I'm going to get it together, Jesus. Okay. So I had, you had integrity, mm-hmm. respectability, and honesty.
Okay.
Okay.
Friendliness.
Okay.
Because I just feel like as a black woman, mm-hmm. sometimes oh. we're not so friendly to one another. And yeah. I'm guilty of it, too, even if it's not it's not on purpose. Mm-hmm. But I feel like we have this thing, like sometimes I'm walking down the street, I'm smiling.
Yeah.
But you're not smiling. But it's like, smile, girl. You right. know what I mean? So that is something that I'm trying to work on. Just right. having a more engaging countenance where it's like, okay, my aura is cool. You ain't got to, you know, feel a certain type of way about me. So that's another one.
Okay, that's good. I like that one.
Friendliness and being accepting.
Okay.
Being accepting of others and wherever walk of life they come from and whatever they bring to the table, just being open and being accepting to them.
I like that.
Thank you.
That's really nice. Do you have another deal breaker or is just
deal like breaker?
A, yeah.
Okay. Deal breakers as far as just like anything or?
Well, I would say platonic or romantic. Is
okay.
there like that? And you could have one for either side or
okay.
one that covers both, but just that one thing that makes you go,
okay.
Check, please.
In romantic relationships, if you mean to your mama.
Oh, yeah.
I just, no. Like you, no. That's not going to. I love when a man is, you know, always speaking well of his mama. And,
right.
you know, just you can just tell that there's a closeness there. I really like that because my okay. dad, he always has valued my grandma. And I Aww. Always just felt that makes me feel good. You know what I mean? So
yeah.
it's like if you respect your mama, you most likely you're going to respect me, hopefully.
It is on the list.
Yes, it's on the list. But I don't really have... It takes a lot for me to get fed up. So I don't have, like, this whole list of
yeah.
do this, do that, do this, or it ain't going to happen. Because
right.
truth be told, you know, someone could do something you would have said that, mm-hmm. you know, you wouldn't take it and you do because you love them or whatever. So
right.
I just leave it up to the Lord. The Lord guide me when it's not right. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
And hopefully I listen.
That's really good. I like that. So last question.
Okay.
When do you feel most confident and what makes you feel most, when and why?
I feel most confident when I look cute,
mm-hmm.
when I'm dressed, how I want to be dressed and feel presentable. And I feel, I definitely feel most confident when I know what I'm doing. If I'm, you know, not sure about
oh, yeah.
something, it will show. And there's right. nothing that I can do to not let it show.
Right.
So those are the times I feel most comfortable.
Excellent.
And
confidence. I love it. All right, you guys, we are going to take a break for station identification. We'll be back in just a moment with Miss Brittany Cooper of The Fly Curve.
Yes.
They can find you online at theflycurve.com.
Yes, ma'am.
All right. So if you want to check out her stylings, you know, you can go to theflycurve.com. Hang tight. We'll be back in just a moment.
You are listening to the San Diego Station of Inspiration. 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, KTAV Radio. For more information on how you can advertise your business, event, or services, please visit us online at ktav.tv or call 619-246-6131.
All right, we are back here in studio with Miss Brittany Cooper of The Fly Curve here on The Simone Edwards Show. So, Brittany, we
yes.
are now going to jump off into the deep end.
Okay.
All right, so how did you get started on the road to entrepreneurship?
Well, I feel like it's always in you.
Mm-hmm.
Of course, my family has always had restaurants and things of that nature. So I grew up working in the restaurants and all that.
Okay.
So it's always been in me to be your own boss.
Okay.
Even if you have a 9-to-5, be working on something that's for you, that's going to, you know, extend your health and your growth and your economic fortune for your family.
Right.
But in regards to my own journey, I had got laid off from my little job, which I hated, by the way. And I would be it, but it was good money, and right. I would be like, "There's no way." Because before this, you was broke. So there's no way for me to justify walking away from this money when you have nothing. You know what right. I mean? So I got laid off very unceremoniously. And it was just, you know, irritating that I got laid off. But I started to think, how can I be my own boss so that I'm never in this position to have to do something that I don't want to do? Or,
right.
you know, so I've always wanted to have a store.
Okay.
And I've always wanted to make women feel good.
Okay.
And, you know, so I was just thinking, okay, what can I do? What can I do? What can I do? And I had this idea for a boutique
mm-hmm.
and that catered to a women of a certain size, you know, like myself, mm-hmm. who was always having trouble, you know, finding clothes, cute clothes.
Right, right, right.
Because clothes are out there, but they're not always cute.
Right.
So, you know.
Or quality. Yeah.
And then they want you to pay $500,000 for t-shirts. So it was just, you know, it was a conglomeration of all of that.
Mm-hmm.
And then once I was applying everywhere, could not find a job to save my little life. So I'm like, this is what I'm supposed to be doing. And
right.
I ran the idea by my dad, and he was like, you should go for it. I mean, there's nothing to lose. So,
right.
I mean, you have nothing anyway, so you might as well go for it. So I did. And that's how I came up with the Fly Curve and been rolling ever since.
Okay. So now how long have you, from that moment until now, how long have you been in business?
Okay, so I got laid off in 2012, and I opened the Fly Curve in October of 2013.
Wow. Mm-hmm. Okay, so like little over a year?
Yeah, over a year.
Okay.
Yeah, because I had to secure, you know, monies and all that, find a building. It was a very long process, but very rewarding.
Talk to us. So for those who are listening who want to be entrepreneurs
mm-hmm.
in whatever capacity, whether fashion or otherwise, talk to them about your process from the moment you realized, okay, I'm going to do this.
Mm-hmm.
And you kind of got, you know, your dad's blessing and you had the support. Mm-hmm. Once that was in place, and we'll talk about the name.
Say, okay.
Don't throw out the name
because
it's a good story behind the name.
Okay.
Talk to us about what you had to do, like some of the practical, technical things that you had to take care of before launching the Fly Curve.
Okay, so when I had the idea, I didn't go to business school. So
right.
I really didn't know what I was supposed to be doing.
Okay.
I just kind of went, you know, step by step, brick by brick. Okay,
mm-hmm.
you need to put, you know, you need to alert the newspaper. You need to put your fictitious business name, those types of things. I knocked those out first.
Mm-hmm.
But the hard part was money. How am I going to get this money to open this store? And I ended up using my own money, which I do not recommend.
Okay, that's good.
If you're able to,
right?
I would recommend getting a loan. Mm-hmm. If you're able,
right.
grants, GoFundMe, anything that's not using your own money, because if it should happen to go down, a lot of businesses, they start, they don't have enough capital to sustain.
Right.
Because you done put your whole life savings into opening it, because it's a lot of money.
Right.
So if I could go back, I would have tried to go to other funding sources.
Gotcha.
But I was just so excited. And I was just like, you know, I'm going to just use my savings and what I had and was able to secure for my own.
Mm-hmm.
Once I did that, I was trying to find a building,
mm-hmm.
which was very difficult. A lot of people don't want to just lease their building. Have you ever been in business before? No. Well, we don't want to lease to you. You don't know what you're doing.
Gotcha.
Same reason why most women and black men cannot secure loans, because they're like asking us, have we ever been in business before?
Mm-hmm.
And we're like, no, well, we can't help you. Well, it's sad, but it's, you know, it's just the way the world works.
Right.
So they want you to be in business for 2 years before they give you a loan. Well, you know,
right.
most businesses don't even last 2 years. Now you want me to, you know. So if I could go back, I wouldn't have used my own money, but that's all I could do at the time.
Right.
So once I did that, I was able to, you know, figure out where to get the clothing from and the
uh-huh.
different products and items from, just by researching.
Okay.
Just by, you know, putting my ear to the street and branding, trying to find a logo, someone to create my logo, which was very hard because it's a personal thing, right?
Right.
You know, I can't draw. So I know what I have in my head, but
uh-huh.
I'm depending on someone else, you know, to create it for me. So that was another step.
Mm-hmm.
Once I had the money and the logo and knew where to, you know, get the clothing, That's when I found a building. Luckily, it was right in the same shopping center as my dad's barbecue restaurant, Coop's West Texas Barbecue. Mm-hmm. And and it was just full steam ahead then. I wasn't so organized then. Mm-hmm. So I was all over the place, but I had good people around me. Mm-hmm. So some business, they say creative people are not the most organized people.
They're right.
That's me. Mm-hmm. I don't really know. I'm not a list person. Mm-hmm. I'm not, you know, so I had to learn that over time. But mm-hmm. luckily, I had people around me mm-hmm. that were able to help me with that. So I have my friend that she's great with the list and color coding and, you know, all that stuff. So she helped me do that. And I have my dad, who was the business head, like, do you really want to spend, you know, $8,000 on flooring? Like, you know, he's practical, you know. And right. then I have my sister who has the fashion eye show me how to put things together. So it was a whole, you know, it was a family. It was a village. So yeah. that's one thing that no one is an island.
Right.
So you can't, if you think you're about to go into business and just be booming all alone, you're wrong.
Right.
You will not, you will fail. So right. After I'd done all that, found the building and everything, we opened. And it was the grace of God. Seriously, yeah. But you know, I bump my head a lot, but I would not trade the experience for anything in the world. I really wouldn't.
Well, the thing that, as I'm listening to your story, Brittany, the things that I love, absolutely love about your story is that you didn't have it all together.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I mean? And nothing against those who do.
Right.
It's just really, it's encouraging to listen, especially for somebody who wants to go out there and they want to get that
yes.
done. Because really the whole purpose of the Woman on the Move series is to empower and encourage other women to get on the move and to do the thing that is burning in their heart to
yeah.
do. You know, so if it's to write the book, write the book.
Right.
If it's to start a business, start the business.
Right.
Whatever the case
right.
may be. And so I love that what you had was a desire and a dream and you had support and
mm-hmm.
you're like, okay, as I go, I'm going to get enough light for the next step that I'm on.
Right.
And I'm just going to go.
Right.
And then the other part of your story that really stands out, that could be a great takeaway for our listeners, is if God has put something in your heart, he will surround you
mm-hmm.
with the village. He'll
Absolutely.
Surround you with the right people.
Absolutely.
Because you had someone to kind of keep you on track
mm-hmm.
business-wise, and
yes.
that was your dad.
Yes.
You had somebody who could keep you organized because that wasn't your strength at the time.
Right, right.
And so it's like, okay, let's get this person to keep mm-hmm. you on task. No, no,
right.
no, no, no.
Exactly.
Stay on the reservation.
Oh, Lord. Bless her heart.
Stay here.
Man.
And then you had someone to help you that you could bounce ideas off of.
Absolutely.
With, the sense of fashion.
Yeah.
And so I think that that's... It's just a great testimony to, if you will take that step of faith,
right, right.
that God will meet you at the point of your need and kind of exceed.
He really will.
Yeah.
He really will. And just even with that, you know, so many people want to go in business and like you were saying, they don't have that,
mm-hmm.
you know, that village around them, or someone's discouraging you or saying, do you know what type of economy we're in? You know, these types of things,
mm-hmm.
that's not your people. That's not your village.
Right.
So find someone who's going to support you and who's going to, you know, speak that life and to your project or idea or business, because
right.
it's very important, because it's a lonely road.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes, absolutely. I love it. So now let's get to one of my favorite parts.
Okay.
Okay. So tell us how, tell us the name for your boutique. We kind of mentioned it, but make
okay.
it official.
The name of my boutique is the Fly Curve Boutique.
Okay. And now tell us, how did the name come about?
Okay. So when I'm a 90s kid. So
okay.
I, you know, had the best shows that were on TV at the time. And
yeah.
one of the best shows on TV at the time was In Living Color.
Mm-hmm.
Well, if anyone's familiar with In Living Color, you know, before and after, they mm-hmm. have the Fly Girls, they come out, they dancing, they cute, you know, they look all good.
Mm-hmm.
But there was no Fly Girls that looked like me, or the women that I knew who were fly.
Mm-hmm.
They had a little bit extra, you know, minutes in the hourglass,
mm-hmm.
you know, that type of thing. And I would always wonder, like, you know, I throughout my life, I know women that are, you know, women of a certain size that are fly.
Mm-hmm.
But they're not represented on TV.
Mm-hmm.
They're not represented culturally. And even in our music, we don't talk about them a lot. You know, so I'm a woman of a certain size, and I've always wanted to be a fly girl. I knew I was fly.
Mm-hmm.
But no one, you know, I didn't have that, you know, appropriation from the outside community.
Right.
So I was... trying to come up with names. I had so many names, like a million names. Mm-hmm. And I'm just like, none of these are like hitting home for me. So I was trying to think of, you know, something that resonated with me. Mm-hmm. And I thought about, you know, when I was a kid, dancing and watching the Fly Girls on A Living Color, and was like, you know what? The Fly. Mm-hmm. But I was like, something else has to, couldn't be the Fly Girls. That's probably like, you know, trademarked somewhere.
Right.
So I wanted something that also encompassed the community that I was wanting to serve, and that was the plus size community.
Right.
So that's how I came with the Fly Curve. The Fly Curve.
Oh, I love it. I love
it. So that's where it came from.
And that really brings a sense of significance mm-hmm. to your brand.
Yeah.
And it brings a sense of depth and weight to your brand that isn't just like, oh, this is this really cute name.
Right.
But the story behind the name is, I wanted representation.
Yes, that's all.
Yeah.
That's all we want. Is to be represented. Yeah.
Right. And to be represented positively.
Right.
And to look fly when we're represented.
Exactly. Because if you think about movies and things, it's mm-hmm. when it's talking of plus size community and that whole thing, it's always like Rasputia. Or, you know, just something out of line. And
right.
It's like, I know women personally who are fly. They're of a certain size. And all of us are not Rasputia.
Right.
All of us are not greedy. All right. of us are not, you know what I'm saying? So
right.
It's just like, I wanted to bring some elegance and some class to that whole idea.
Right.
Like, you can really be fly at any size.
I love it. I absolutely love it. Talk to us about the most challenging thing about being in business for yourself, and the most rewarding?
The most challenging thing is keeping yourself motivated.
Okay, that's good.
Because, like I said, it's a lonely road. Mm-hmm. So everything, you're in charge of everything, mm-hmm. is what I had to learn. Mm-hmm. So one of the most challenging things is being able to delegate mm-hmm. and trying to, you know, it's your baby, so you want to have control of everything.
Right.
You know, but trying to delegate and, you know, do that whole thing and keep yourself motivated along the way, because sometimes the cash register is not ringing like
right.
that. So you need to remember why you did it. And so that's the most challenging thing.
What's the most rewarding?
Most rewarding thing is seeing all these fly, beautiful women in my clothes that I picked out.
Right.
That I thought someone might look good in. And they right. thought the same thing too, and they bought it. And that really is rewarding to me.
Oh, that is awesome. All right, you guys, we are going to take a break for station identification. We will be back in studio with Miss Brittany Cooper of The Fly Curve. Visit theflycurve.com. We'll be back in just a moment. All right, we are back here in studio with Miss Brittany Cooper of The Fly Curve. You can check her out. Check out her goods at yes. theflycurve.com. More than just a cute name, it is a name with depth and weight to it. So if you are a woman who is size pretty, plus size,
yes.
a woman of a certain size, you are fluffy and fabulous,
yes.
and you're looking for clothing that represents you and will keep you fly as you represent yourself in the community, definitely check out Miss Brittany Cooper at The Fly Curve. So let's talk some more about this business venture and being an entrepreneur.
Okay.
What have your failures taught you?
My failures have taught me that, you know, just if you fail, mm-hmm. that you're not a failure.
That's good.
That idea may have failed or right. not as gone as well as you would have thought, or it wasn't properly executed, what have you. That doesn't mean you're a bad person
or
you know, or something wrong with you. Mm-hmm. You just have to learn from it and move forward. And I'm a type of person, I'm a very emotional person. So okay. it's like, oh man, you know, that didn't work out, you know, whatever. But I had to learn, like, first of all, you got to be strong and you have to be tough. Mm-hmm. And you have to be able to pinpoint. Another thing that it taught me is that you need to pinpoint when it's not working.
That's good.
Yeah.
That's really good.
So that you're not beating a dead horse and you're being productive.
Right.
Because, you know, you'll stay in things just because you're used to it.
Right.
And it's not serving anyone any good purpose. So just being able to kind of pinpoint. That's another thing being an entrepreneur. You don't get fired. So right. it's not like you're doing bad and then somebody like, you're fired.
Right.
You need to pinpoint yourself. Something's not working, not to switch this around, need to do this, need to go this way, go this direction, you know, so you really need to pray.
So really, it sounds as though it's always being in a constant state of innovation.
Right.
And never really allowing yourself to grow stagnant.
Right. Because something may be working for 6 months, mm-hmm. And then it's not working anymore. But you can't think, well, for 6 months it was working. Okay, for 6 months it wasn't working. Now it's not. What's the next move? Because if you allow yourself to get stuck, it was not going to work out.
That's really good.
Yeah.
And it sounds as though it creates a sense of flexibility.
Mm-hmm.
Because then it's like, you're not so rigid.
You're not so married to one idea.
Right.
And because life is changing. Everything's changing. The only constant thing is change.
Right.
So nothing's going to stay the same. That's one of the most biggest takeaways mm-hmm. that I've gotten from running my own business is that things change, people change, whatever. You need to be able to jump in that water and kind of go with the flow, basically.
Sound advice. Very sound advice. And I love the fact that you pointed out that just because something failed doesn't make you a failure.
Right.
That I think that's so important because it seems, you know, it's human nature
mm-hmm.
to want to kind of down yourself and to say, oh, well, right. I didn't do so great in this. And
right.
it's because, or to assign blame or whatever the case may be,
yeah.
or just to look at it as, no, that particular idea
right.
didn't work well. What can I extract from it that's
exactly.
good and throw the rest away?
Right, because there might be some good pieces in it
right.
that you can take and, you know, restructure. So it's not a complete failure. You know, there's something in there. I don't care if it's one little teeny tiny thing. There's something that you can take that, okay, I'm going to build it around this because this is working.
Mm-hmm.
And it also talks, you know, it goes to the village as well because when you fail at something, it's, you know, it's the people around you.
Mm-hmm.
Build you back up, encourage you. Okay, it's okay. Mm-hmm. You know, keep going. Don't stop. You know, so it's all important. It's all intertwined.
I love it. Absolutely love it. I want to say this before we segue to the next question. You know how you talked about that little teeny tiny thing?
Mm-hmm.
Oftentimes, that little teeny tiny thing that we're so quick to kind of discard
right.
could be the very cog that sparks the catalyst for the next
Absolutely
thing.
Absolutely true.
So for somebody who's listening, I really want to let you know, like, go back and look at it again.
Yeah.
You know, go back and look at that area where something failed or it didn't go the way that you planned. Go back and look at it again and find out what is that thing
right.
that you can extract that will be the catalyst to move you in the direction that you're supposed to go.
Definitely.
Okay, next question. I love this question. What do you do to challenge yourself so that your successes don't make you complacent?
Okay. So one of the things that I do on the daily, I'm always looking at brands that are bigger than me.
That's good.
That, you know, because it's easy to just, you know, I'm booming in my own little area.
Mm-hmm.
Well, there's a big old world out there. So you know what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm.
So it's like, you know, it's easy to just focus on your little area
right.
of what you're doing, but there's people out there doing it better and bigger. So I'm always on their Instagram, on their websites, trying to see what, you know, I can take, what can I use, what can I do
mm-hmm.
to, you know, expand my brand. And, you know, they say you're your biggest competition, and that is true. But also, the people who are making millions and millions of dollars in revenue are your biggest competition, too.
Right.
So they're doing something right. So mm-hmm. I always try to look at them, their marketing campaigns. How does it look? You mm-hmm. know, what is it speaking to? How does it make you feel? And I'm always trying to do that so that I don't get complacent with my, you know, small business. Because one day I hope to be on their level.
Excellent.
You know.
So now, here's a question that I have for you. With that, as you are, and there's a great book called Steal Like an Artist.
Okay.
As you are stealing like an artist, how do you then look at what, let's say, Lane Bryant,
mm-hmm.
right? Or Ashley...
Stewart.
Ashley Stewart. Yes. I was going to say Ashley Smith. No, Stewart.
That's a black lady.
I'm here. but as you're looking at, let's say, Ashley Stewart, how do you look at what they do and kind of go, yeah, I want to do that, bring it down to your level, mm-hmm. and then personalize it to make it work for the fly curve so that it's not this weird appendage
right.
that's hanging on your business.
Right. Well, one thing I do, I look at the good things that they're doing and some of the not so good things that they're doing.
Okay.
So I'm like, okay, yeah, no. Because I'm a customer first.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm always thinking, like, that didn't make me feel too cool when they did that. Right. Or they did. I just go off of a feeling. I mm-hmm. go off of how does it make me feel.
Right.
And I feel like that's what a lot of larger brands do. So that's what I try to bring to the fly curve. How does it make you feel when
right.
you're, you know, when we're engaging via email or, you know, when you get your package in the mail? Like, how do you feel?
Right.
So that's one thing that I do take away, you know, from them. And then, you know, I personalize it to my own just by putting my own spin on it, you know, of how, you know, I would package things or how I would do things.
Mm-hmm.
So that's one way.
I love it.
Thank you.
I absolutely love that. And I like the fact that you use that as a motivator for mm-hmm. yourself. Because
yeah.
you're right. Yes, on this level,
right,
you are your own competition.
Yes.
But when you start to look at, okay, I want to get up this mountain.
Right.
Who's at the top of the mountain?
Right.
What are they doing?
Right.
Okay. I love that. Excellent advice. Are you naturally, and I think you kind of answered this mm-hmm. a little bit, so we'll get into more detail.
Okay.
Since you are not naturally time conscious okay. and organized, how did you learn to become that?
Okay.
I know in the beginning you had help.
Mm-hmm.
How did that evolve?
Well, I really wish I was. That's the thing.
Okay.
I really wish that I was a list person and, mm-hmm. you know, but I'm just not. So one thing, I had to just be honest with myself.
That's good.
You need 2.5 hours to get ready. You need to get ready a little bit earlier.
Right.
Whether it's with your marketing, you know, whatever, trying to send, you know, it's Thanksgiving, but Christmas is coming. So, you know, I have to be on top of it with sending out Christmas marketing,
mm-hmm.
you know, just being more cognizant of myself
mm-hmm.
and not, you know, my friend always says, I suffer from this disease where I think I have more time than I do.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I'm like, oh, it'll take us 20 minutes to get over there. She's like, girl, we're going to LA. It's going to take 2 hours, you know? So.
Right.
That's one thing. Just being conscious
mm-hmm.
of what you're doing and right. how much time you realistically need.
Right.
So that's one thing that I try to employ.
Okay.
And then I did become a list person. I write down everything. Now, they're all on different post-its.
Right.
But I'm writing them down so that they're out of my head and that I'm clear.
And so, oh my gosh, can I just, because I'm a list, I've become a list person.
Okay,
sometimes
okay.
I don't always execute the list, but at least I wrote it down
right.
and I know where to find it.
Right.
But what it does, it really does free you up.
Yes.
Because if you're kind of walking around with this to-do list in your head, it's blocking.
Really, it really does.
And especially for those of us who are people of faith,
mm-hmm.
and you're praying and you're asking God for direction, but you've got this list.
Too many tabs open.
Too many tabs.
Yeah.
And so it's kind of like, no, you need to write that down.
Right.
So that you can free that space up to hear, for creativity to come in.
Absolutely.
For thoughts. I love it.
Yeah. So I have been more cognizant of that. Let me just write this down mm-hmm. because, you know, it gets it off of me and on this paper where I can, you know, build a web around it and maybe come up with more ideas. You
right.
know, I find the post-its everywhere and I'm working on that, but at least I'm writing it down.
Right.
So that I've been trying to be more conscious of that and, you know, using a calendar.
Yeah.
Because I'm one person be like, okay, the 15th, right? Great. 15th, it'll be the 14th, and they're like, oh, remember when you said you were coming to sing at my, and I don't have a clue, because it didn't really mesh with me, so I put it in the calendar now.
Okay, so I have a planner for you. Okay. I'm going to recommend to you.
Okay.
I am. And they're not even paying me. I'm doing this for free. So if anyone from the Passion Planner is listening and you want to hook the Simone Edwards show up with free planners for the rest of our lives, we will take it. Or you want to send Angela into the studio to interview, we will take that too. But Passion Planner.
Okay.
I really believe that a coworker actually turned me onto it.
Okay.
And how I discovered it was I had tried the Franklin Covey system. I tried all these different planners, and they weren't working for me. And okay. I was getting very frustrated because their start and end time
yes.
was either not early enough or too early when they ended. And so I prayed about it, and I was just, and I remember my prayer. It was very specific. And I said, you know, God, you know me.
Mm-hmm.
So what planner is going to work for me?
Okay.
I kid you not, within less than 72 hours, my coworker and I were talking. And she was like, oh, yeah, my sister does this, and she mm-hmm. makes jewelry and blah, blah,
okay.
blah. And she uses this planner, and I love it. You should check it out.
Okay.
And she showed me her planner. First of all, it starts from, it's visual.
Okay.
It starts from Sunday to Saturday.
Perfect.
I can see the entire week in front of me.
Okay.
It ends at, I want to say, 10 or 11 o'clock at night, and it starts at 6 a.m.
Yes,
in the morning.
That's because that's how it's supposed to be. And that's, if you're an entrepreneur, those are your hours anyway.
Those are your hours.
Yeah.
At the top, it has this week's focus.
Mm-hmm.
At the bottom, and this was a part I really loved, it said personal to-do list, work to-do list.
Okay.
So all this stuff, because I have a 9-to-5. So all the stuff I needed to work on for my personal,
okay.
I could put on this section.
Perfect.
Everything I need to do for work, I could list out here.
Okay.
And then they have this little space underneath called the space of infinite possibilities.
Mm-hmm.
And it's like you can doodle, write, whatever. And for a person who's creative, it's so perfect because I can flip open my planner. I can plan out for the week and I can kind of see, okay, here's when I need to get stuff done.
Okay.
I can color my planner.
Yeah, because you know, that's a thing.
Girl, yeah.
It's really a thing.
It
yeah.
colors and little stickers. And when I work out, and I have results. What? But we said
Boom.
March, so no revealing till
don't,
March.
Don't put it on them yet. Don't do it.
But, you know, I can, like, put my little workout thing and put a little sticker there, or
okay.
a little go me.
Okay.
You know,
Perfect.
And highlight it. And so you can see it.
That's awesome. Okay.
So I want to pass that. That's my gift to you.
Okay, I'm going to look into that.
Yes.
One last thing I was going to say
yes.
about that. Waking up early.
Oh, God.
Because when I was on unemployment,
mm-hmm.
I will wake up. I'll take me a little nap around 10.
Mm-hmm.
You know, go to the gym. Take me another nap after Different World goes off. Because he used to come on it, too. So I'm like, you know, I'm going to go to sleep. And then, you know, maybe I'll just, you know, trapeze about and then mm-hmm. lay back down. You know, I love sleep.
Okay.
So when I opened the business, it's like, you know, you can't even operate like this. I was exhausted at 2 because that's my nap time. So,
right.
you know, I had to start waking up early. Like, waking up early, you know, working out, talking to the Lord early.
Mm-hmm.
Because you will miss it if you're trying to sleep till 1. And that's a misconception.
Right.
People feel like, you can do whatever you want when you're an entrepreneur.
Mm-mm.
Oh, no. You probably on a more strict schedule than you were working, you know, wherever you were working.
Right.
So that's my thing.
Absolutely love it. I absolutely love that about being learning to be time conscious
yeah.
and making the list
yeah.
and waking up early.
Yeah.
And that being it. And I love the fact that you shattered the myth that being an entrepreneur for those who aren't. Because
mm-hmm.
anytime you're outside of something, it
looks
a certain
way.
Right. And so for those who are on the outside looking in, it's not a free money,
no.
free boss.
Oh, no, because you're going to be broke.
but you will love it. It will be the toughest job you ever love.
Exactly.
Right?
That's perfect.
Yeah.
It's not all just, you know, money. Just, you know, just, no.
Right.
You will face some hard times chasing your dream,
right.
but it's so worth it. It's
yeah.
yours.
Right.
You know, so.
And I love the fact that you brought in that it's important to be disciplined
mm-hmm.
because the life you were living before.
Right. The life of leisure.
Yet.
Unemployment.
That life will not fit over here
no.
on this side.
No.
I absolutely love it. So. What are some pitfalls, with that said, before we close out this segment, what are some pitfalls that budding entrepreneurs can avoid?
Thinking you know everything.
That's good.
Because you don't.
Mm-hmm.
And there's always someone, even if it's a bad idea, I listen to them all.
Right.
So that's one thing. Mm-hmm. We talked about organization.
Yeah.
Whether you're getting a planner or you're doing something, get something because you want to stay on top of your stuff. And one thing is always never not oversee your finances. Mm. Always keep a close watch on, you know, on what's going on with the money. And to that end, know all about the taxes and what you, I don't know, if you got to attend a seminar, whatever you got to do, know about that because it's important and it'll come back to bite you if you're not versed on it.
Right.
And, yeah, that's pretty much the most important thing.
Those are some really good pitfalls to avoid,
yeah,
though. I mean, especially when it comes to taxes because,
yeah,
you know, it's not this, again, it's not the sense of free money.
No.
If you have a 9-to-5 and you have an influx of money coming in, trust and believe the federal government is, they want their part.
And they want to know, mm-hmm, what's going on. And also quarterly taxes, those were kicking my butt. I didn't even know about them.
Right.
But every 4 months they want some of that money that, mm-hmm, you made. So
right,
it's just like being versed, right, on, no, if you're going into the clothing industry, know all there is to know.
Right.
About it, you know who's on top, who's, you know the movers and the shakers, and it will really serve you. Networking is like the most important thing.
I love it, and I love the fact that you really emphasize the importance of research.
Yeah.
And that's one of the things that I noticed even as you were talking about your journey. You talked about, I didn't know this and I had to look, mm-hmm, this up, and I didn't know this and I had to go research, and
right,
I didn't know about this over here,
right,
but I studied and I found out. And it's so important to, like you said, not walk in with this, I got it, I know it, or
yeah,
it's just kind of all magically fall into place.
Yeah. Because it won't. I'm a witness.
All right. We are going to take a break for station identification, and we will be back with Miss Brittany Cooper of The Fly Curve. Check her out at theflycurve.com. We'll be back in just a moment.
Do you have any questions, comments, or concerns about today's show? Would you like to share your testimony or any constructive critiques? Would you like to know how to be a guest on The Simone Edwards Show? Please feel free to email us at thesimoneedwardsshow@gmail.com. We are also available on Facebook, Pinterest, and Instagram. Be sure to follow us to receive updates regarding the show and our other ministries.
All right, we are headed towards, we're about 15 minutes away from the top of the hour, and we're heading to the last section of our interview with Miss Brittany Cooper of The Fly Curve. So Brittany, why did you choose to get into the arena of fashion?
Well, I just felt like there was a lack in the marketplace,
mm-hmm,
for, you know, plus size women, plus size clothing, even just locally in,
right,
our city.
Mm-hmm.
There's not, I mean, there's a few places you can go, but then you got to, you know, like spend an arm and a leg.
Right.
So my thing was, what I wanted to do was, you know, provide quality clothing, a nice space,
mm-hmm,
and at affordable prices.
Mm-hmm.
That was cute.
Right.
That was fly. Too.
Yeah.
You know, because you can go to different places and they have something for you to put on, but it's like, why? I don't want to wear that.
Right.
That doesn't represent who I am.
Right.
So, I wanted to do that. I felt like that there was room for it in the marketplace for it.
Excellent. How do you go about selecting your pieces? Like, how do you, you know, you go to your vendor,
mm-hmm,
and you're like, okay, I want to purchase, and there's like 50 dresses in front of you.
Mm-hmm.
How do you pick the 5 that will appear in your store?
Well, what I do is I always ask, you know, what I want to wear, what I want to put this on.
Right.
And then I will ask, you know, the closest people to me, would you wear this? How would you feel, you know, in this?
Mm-hmm.
And based on those things, and I also look at what's trendy, you know, what's out there. Because sometimes it'll be in straight sizes and you'll be like, that will really be cute. But then you can't find it anywhere. Like,
gotcha.
Searching in the daylight with a flashlight, can't find it anywhere.
Wow.
So I try to include those things in my, like, one of the big trends for the winter was velvet.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, people were like, plus girls don't wear velvet. Well, yes, we do.
Right.
If they had it, we would put it on. So, you know, those types of things. And those dresses did really well. So it's all about, it's a mixture. Because some things I like haven't sold.
Right.
And then, you know, I'll ask people, would you wear this? And they say yes. And I'm thinking, why? But, you know, everyone's different. So I just try to, you know, keep it open. You
okay.
know?
That's really good. I want to talk really, you brought something up and touch on it as much as you can.
Okay.
About some of the discriminatory practices that take place in the fashion industry between the more traditional sizes and plus size availability.
Well, for starters, it's getting a little better, but there are brands who were traditionally straight size. They know that the plus size market will spend money, has money to spend, wants to look cute. So they know that, so they're trying to capitalize on that. So what they'll do is they have this large department store, and then they'll put the plus size way in the back, in the, you know, or at, down in the basement, or, you know, somewhere. It's just like, we have, then they're advertising, we have plus size. So you go in and you all excited. And it's like four things and a hat, you know, and leggings. So it's just like, okay, you know what I mean? So
right.
That to me is very discriminatory, because you're trying to capitalize off this and you're not thinking about the woman who's buying it. You're not even concerned with her. You're just concerned about making money off of her.
Right.
So that's one thing. And the other thing is the fat tax, which is what I like to talk about. And that's two items. One's a medium and one's a 2X. Well, you going to charge this woman $40 more than you would this woman because it's a little bit larger. Well, in the way that I do business and my modality, which is online now, I don't have to do that because my overhead is not as large as it once was. So I'm able to just charge what it's supposed to be charged versus let me add more because there's less of it and because, you know, it probably costs a little bit more money to make. I really think it's a fat tax and I'm over it.
Yeah.
I really am.
So with that said, I want to jump down a little bit. How important is it for, and speak specifically to your demographic.
Okay.
Because kind of like with, you know, black women and natural hair, it's definitely a lot more pervasive and a lot more open than it has been in our history.
Yes.
And so there are a lot more options that are available to women of a certain size.
Yes.
Women who want the plus in their size.
Right.
Since there are more options that are available now than there were before. And we still have, you know, a hill to climb and obstacles to overcome.
Right.
Speak to the woman who is facing challenges, who wants to be fly, but kind of hasn't found her style. Talk to that person about how important it is to define your style. Like, what's the psychological ramifications behind just kind of floating out there?
Well, one thing that I always think of is, are you comfortable?
Right.
What if you want to try something new, by all means, that's one thing. Just try something new, step out of your box a little bit. But once you put it on, does it make you feel good? Because so many things are trendy and, you know, you put it on and even though everyone else is wearing it, you don't feel good in it because that's not what you're supposed to be wearing. So I always think, how does it make you feel? Do I feel pretty in this? Because that's what it's for. It's an accessory. It's, you know, to make you feel good. So in defining your own personal style, that's one thing that I personally do. Although it may look good on such and such, does it look good on me? You know, I really think that's important because, like you said, it is more open and there are a lot more options, but everything is not for everybody.
Right.
And I'm a person who likes to dress for my body. I don't want to put that on anyone else, but I just think that just because it's out there don't mean it's for you.
Right.
But if it makes you feel good and it speaks to what you're trying to present to the world, go for it.
Okay, so I'm going to give I want you to do a mental dress.
Okay.
Okay? So we have leggings.
Okay.
And there are some women who are kind of like, leggings are available. They're available in plus size. I want to wear leggings.
Right.
Leggings in plus size.
Okay.
As you stated, every fashion item is not for every body type.
Right.
So how would you counsel a person who wants to wear leggings that's, you know, of a certain size in a way that is still going to satisfy their need, help them define personal style, help them to look good and to feel pretty.
Yes.
Not just in their own estimation, but in reality.
So you're not looking crazy.
Yes.
Right. Well, the thing about leggings are there's different types. So some of them are sheer. Right. So we don't want to wear those as pants because they're not pants. They're sheer. They're almost like stockings.
Right.
So would you walk outside with just stockings on? No, you know what I mean? So it's like thinking about it. So there's different leggings. There's liquid leggings. And mm-hmm. there's the thicker leggings. I personally would counsel a woman to wear the thicker leggings if you're going to wear a shirt that's above the waist. Mm-hmm. You know, that's, you know, going to cut kind of high. Mm-hmm. You can dress your leggings up or you can dress them down. And if you are going to work or something, you don't want to wear the sheer leggings. So
right.
you can wear a top that will cover mm-hmm. your bottom, and it elongates you mm-hmm. and it makes you look a little thinner than you might be. Mm-hmm. And that's cool too if you're going for that look. Right. But more so, I don't want to say plus women should not wear leggings, because plus women should wear whatever they want to wear.
Okay.
But make sure that they're sturdy, mm-hmm. that the material, you know, because some leggings are like $2. So mm-hmm. you're getting a $2 product.
Gotcha.
You know, so just make sure that they're sturdy and that the material is good material that will cover what needs to be covered.
Love it. Absolutely love it. Segueing back to the business.
Okay.
What is the end game for the fly curve? What is your end game?
Well, right now I am looking to extend to different areas that I love. Like, I was a communication major. Mm-hmm. So I wanted to be like on the radio. Mm-hmm. So podcasts are like really big right now. So I'm looking to expand into that area.
That's good.
And just lifestyle brands, you know, mm-hmm. making it more of a lifestyle brand, like cups and mugs and sweatshirts and, you know, that type of thing.
I love it.
Yeah, so that's where I'm looking to go.
Okay.
In the 2017.
Well, very nice. There might be room here for you at KTV.
Oh, you
to,
never know.
Start your podcast.
He's like, mm-hmm.
This might be the beginning
well.
Of the Brittany Cooper podcast. Get your fashion advice here every Thursday.
Well, I'm open.
What fashion style, what styles influence you and why?
Well, I always feel like I'm overdressed when I do things.
Okay.
But one person that I love to look at is, you remember Breakfast at Tiffany's?
Oh, yeah.
What was her name?
Audrey Hepburn.
I mean, she just was classic.
God, yeah.
You know, in
yeah.
the way that she dresses. And
yeah.
so, you know, I always wanted to be like her. Mm-hmm. But I go for comfort and I go for cute. And I go for dressing for my body.
That's nice.
You know, so that's where I'm at with it.
Is there a designer? Do you have a favorite designer? Mm-hmm. Who's your designer?
My favorite designer is Monique C. She's based out of New York. I love her. She's a black-owned business.
Okay.
She started with $10,000. She's a multi-million dollar brand now.
Wow.
Yeah, and I love her stuff, like, a lot.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, I love her. If you're listening, I love you. No,
she will be, because the Simone yes. Edwards Show will be global.
International.
So are there any other designers? Is she the designer that you feel has changed the game, or is her style just something that you gravitate towards?
I want to say that she did change the game, because she's like, more of an upper echelon pricing.
Okay.
So before, like I was saying, you know, brands would have available clothing, but it wouldn't be that hot. Mm-hmm. But she has the clothing that you want to wear to, you know, a birthday shindig or, you know, an award show or, you know, and then it's fitted for your body, which I love.
Oh, that's nice.
Show off what you got, girl.
Yeah. Okay. well, you heard it here on the Simone Edwards Show.
You heard it here first.
You heard it here first. I'm going to walk around and say, Brittany said to do it.
Yeah, why not?
So as a seller of clothing, and we'll close out with this.
Okay.
How do you view fashion overall? Not just necessarily for the one particular individual that we spoke of with the leggings, but mm-hmm. how do you view fashion overall and its impact on a person's psychological well-being?
I just feel like, If you if you're dressed good, you feel good. And, you know, so many times you will hear a woman say, I don't have anything to wear. Mm-hmm. You know, I always say that. I'm constantly saying, well, I don't have anything to wear. And my friend, Danielle, if she's listening, she's always like, girl, you got so many clothes. But what I'm really saying is, I don't have anything to wear that's what I want, that's going to represent me today. Because today I might be different than I was yesterday. And I'm trying to, you know, invoke a certain look. You know, so it's all mental. Mm-hmm. And I feel like if you see something, you like it, put it on. Don't let society tell you, well, big girls, they ain't supposed to wear stripes and they ain't supposed to. If you want to wear it, wear it. And I feel like a person who does that is happier.
Right.
I feel like their psyche is better because they're doing what they want to do on their own terms.
And
that's how I try to live my life.
So let me ask you a question. I don't know if you've considered this. Have you considered segueing into becoming a fashion consultant?
I've thought about it, and I sometimes I feel like I am one, but I don't know. I don't know if I got the chops.
Because let's say someone buys clothing outside of the fly curve, but they're kind of, after listening to the show, they're like, wow, Brittany, I really like what you have to say. Mm-hmm. How do I put all of this together?
Oh,
would you be available for that?
Oh, yeah, I'm open to that. Open to that, yeah.
And how would they get in touch with you?
Well, I'm on Facebook, Brittany Cooper, theflycurve.com. You can always message me on there. If you need to reach me directly, theflycurve@gmail.com.
Excellent. All right. Well, we've come to the end of our interview with Miss Brittany Cooper of theflycurve.com. For you ladies who are listening and even for the gentlemen in our audience.
Buy something for your wife.
Yes, buy something for your wife, your mom, your significant your girlfriend.
Your boo.
Yeah, your boo. Fiance, whatever the case may be.
Right.
You want to bless those of us here at the Simone Edwards Show, send us a gift certificate. We won't mind.
Yes.
Well, we've come to the end of our interview, and we sincerely hope that on both sides of the aisle, that if you are thinking about segueing into becoming an entrepreneur, that you heard something today that will challenge you, inspire you, motivate you to take that additional step. If you're not looking to own a business, but maybe there's a book or something you want to write, we want to encourage you, that we hope that you're encouraged by Brittany's testimony. If you're just tuning in, we're going to have the interview up and archived on our YouTube page in just a moment. We'll be sure to send the information out. If you want to catch up on our shows, go to the Simone Edwards Show. We are on YouTube. You can also follow us on Instagram and like our page on Facebook. Until next time, we hope that you have a wonderful rest of your Saturday. Brittany, thank you so much
for
joining us.
Thank you for
having me. Absolutely. If you want to check out some plus size styles, then you can go to theflycurve.com.
Yes.
All right. We'll see you next time.